In the last week, we were discussing from third canto, chapter 21 and 22, wherein in chapter 21, being instructed by Lord Brahma, Karadva Muni, one of his sons who was born through his shadow, performed severe austerities for 10,000 celestial years or something like that. Then he had darshan of Lord Vishnu. He offered prayers and he requested the Lord that my father ordered me to get married and beget children. Please give me a suitable wife. For that, Lord Vishnu replied that, I knew what was there in your heart. I will give you the suitable wife who will be coming in next 2 days. Svayambhu Manu along with his wife will bring their daughter who will be your wife, who will be very suitable to you in all respects. And also I'll give you Prema Bhakti. And after marrying her, after begetting children, you should renounce and travel all over the forest, giving compassion to all the living entities, Daya Sarva Bhuteshu. And just like you have performed your Brahmachari Ashram, the duties of your Brahmachari Ashram very perfectly, similarly perform, showing compassion to all the living entities, taking care of all the living entities by providing what they need in your Gurastha Ashram, and showing compassion to all the living entities by giving them fearlessness, Abhayadan, in your Vanaprastha Ashram, eventually will attain me. And before leaving, he also told that, my dear Kardama, I will also appear in one of my expanded form as your son. And then propagate Tattva Samhita. So having mentioned that, Lord departed. And then, so hoping that in 2 days, Svayambhu Manu would come. So Kardama Muni was begin to perform his daily course of activities. And as predicted by the Lord, on the second day, Svayambhu Manu on his golden chariot, along with his wife and daughter Devahuti, they came to the ashram of our Kardama. So that is beautiful description of that ashram, surrounded by Bindu Sarovar, is nicely described. And Bindu Sarovar became so special, though it was the water of Saraswati River, the entire area is surrounded by Saraswati River. But the Bindu Sarovar became very special because Lord cast one of his teardrops in that lake. So this place became very special for all the sages to reside next to it. Having witnessed the beauty and serene environment around Bindu Sarovar, the entire ashram area, Svayambhu Manu enters the ashram of Kardama Muni, where Kardama, after performing his morning oblations, seated in silence. So looking at Kardama, who was sitting there like a fire covered with ashes, he was very happy, offered obeisances, Dandavat. Then Kardama Muni, touching him, made him sit on the proper sitting place. And then Kardama Muni glorified Svayambhu Manu, saying that you are perfect representative of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. You are taking care of the citizens very nicely in the kingdom, etc., etc. Then feeling embarrassed, Svayambhu Manu replied. Svayambhu Manu replied to Kardama Muni, saying that, my dear great sage, the Supreme Lord created Brahmanas through his heart and he created Kshatriyas through his hands. The both are meant to protect each other. The Brahmanas are meant to propagate the teachings of the Vedic literature, and the Kshatriyas are meant to protect the Brahmanas so that the propagation could happen very nicely. And both are interdependent on each other, so they need to protect each other. So today my life has become successful because of two things. It is very rare to attain the darshan of the people like you, but still I have darshan. Not only that, I could offer obeisances to you, and my head is touched with the dust of your feet. Mahatpada Rajobhishekam. It is very rare opportunity for the kings like me to get darshan of great sages like you. So like that he mentioned. And then more than that, I also heard from you that I am acting as a perfect example of the Supreme Lord. I am taking care of the people in general very nicely. So my life has become successful It is you people, it is you Brahmanas have to ascertain that whether we are work, whether we are doing our duties properly or not. You have ascertained that I am doing my duties properly. So my life has become successful. So like that, having praised that, having indicated that it is very great, rare fortune to have darshan like great sages like you. And then he said that, but still I have come here with one worry in my heart, though I don't have any other worries. One worry is there in my heart. That is due to because of my beautiful daughter. So this daughter of mine is the sister of Priyavrata and Uttanapada. And having heard from Narada Muni, she decided that you are suitable to her as her husband because your age, conduct and qualities are suitable to her. And she was very much pleased about your qualities, form, learning and conduct because she heard from Narada Muni about all those things. So she decided that she want to marry you. She want to become your wife. So kindly accept her as your wife. So because when the sense objects come on their own, one should accept. When they are not, when they are, otherwise, if you deny now out of shame and later on if you ask, you will be, your fame will be, you will be neglected by others. Your fame will be lost. So I also heard that you have accepted only Upakurvana Brahmacharya principles. You did not accept Naishthika Brahmacharya principles, that you wanted to marry and beget children. This is what I have heard from Supreme Lord. That's why I have come here. Kindly accept the hand of my daughter. So Swayambhu Muni speaking all these things only with the intention to please Kardama Muni so that he will not deny the hand of Devahuti. So he made it clear from all points of view that Kardama wanted to marry. That was known by the Supreme Lord himself to Swayambhu Muni. Thus he came here. And Devahuti also wanted to marry Kardama Muni upon hearing from Narada Muni, etc. other things, other people. So and Swayambhu Muni and his wife Satarupa were also pleased that his daughter is going to be married to a great personality like Kardama. So from all respects, it is all proper. So by presenting all these things, so Swayambhu Muni wanted to make Kardama not to feel shy in any respect, since he already decided to marry a girl and beget children in order to fulfill the instruction of his father Brahma. So please accept my daughter, and like that he is requesting. So that was the conversation which we had discussed and stopped in the last week. So if there are any question based on last week's discussion, so we'll quickly take and then we'll go ahead. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Yeah, there are a few. Just give me a minute. Search.
In the meantime, others have any queries based on the previous class discussion?
In the 27th verse of
27th verse of previous chapter
21. It is like in the purport, it has been mentioned that according to the Vedic system, the last line of the purport, according to the Vedic system, therefore, the girl is given over to a suitable boy by the parents and she is never allowed to select her own husband independently. So,
yes.
In this light, how we understand the Swayamvar thing, because in earlier days there used to be Swayamvar, and the word Swayamvar itself means that the girl used to choose her own husband.
See, choosing a husband under the consent of the parents was allowed, but against to the consent of the parents was never allowed in the Vedic culture. So here also, she did not go and inform Kardamuni that I heard about you and I want to marry you. She informed it to her parents, and parents only brought her all the way up to the ashram of Kardamuni. You see the difference. Leaving the woman to choose her husband, and she goes into the streets and finds out a person to be her husband. That kind of system is never allowed in Vedic culture. Even though the women get to hear about the men and they would express their desire to marry so and so person to their friends, through their friends it would be known to their mothers, through mother it would be known to the father. So like that, the father would understand that, okay, my daughter want to marry him, but let the marriage happen in a bona fide way. So they would invite for Swayamvar. Even in the Swayamvar also, she would select the one whom she wanted to marry without any this thing. If she had not decided on that, the fathers would make a condition. Whoever wins that condition, like Sita Swayamvar, Draupadi Swayamvar, like that. So whoever wins that condition, they will get the hand of that princess. So like that, it used to happen like that.
So in that case, Prabhuji, like if the princess is willing to marry somebody else, but in case like that person is not able to fulfill the condition kept for the jo bhi swayamvar ke liye condition rakha rahega, so then she will not be able to marry that person, no? Like,
yeah, sometimes it happened. That was the case with Amba. It happened with Amba. It's like that. So the whole Mahabharata goes after that. So there could be sometimes like that, but generally, if the girl is decided and father is decided, they may not put any condition. The simple condition is that, okay, on whomsoever she puts the garland, that person will be her husband in presence of everyone. So like that it would happen. Condition is kept only in some special cases sometimes.
Okay. Okay, Prabhuji. And there's one more question, Prabhuji, from the same chapter, 34th verse. 34th verse, Parpat. It is in the second para of the Parpat. Somewhere in the middle it comes. Shall I read, Prabhuji? Yeah.
Yeah, tell, read.
Only those who are already liberated from material bondage can become devotees of the Lord. And those who are not liberated from material bondage cannot understand transcendental devotional service. So, is it referring to devotees? Because we see like many devotees, including me, everyone, like we still have so many material desires. We are not completely cleansed of material desires.
Mm.
In fact, that is why we are not reached at the platform of pure devotion.
Mm.
We are still sadhana bhaktas. So how we understand this, like those who are liberated from material bondage can only become devotees of the Lord. Like, is it referring to the pure devotees then? What?
Yes, yes. Understanding about the Lord means not theoretically, but practically experiencing the Lord. Like Dhruva Maharaj, when he had darshan of the Supreme Lord, he had complete understanding of the Supreme Lord. Like Brahma, when he had darshan of Lord Vishnu, he had complete understanding of the Supreme Lord, like that. Now, theoretically, we are reading textbooks, we are seeing some images here and there, etc. So, we have some theoretical understanding. But practical understanding will come only when our heart is completely purified. So, in that way. Atha Sri Krishna Namadi Nabhavayat Grahya Mindriya Sevon Mukhehi Jivado Swayam Eva Spurati Yada. So when one's heart is completely purified, the Lord will make his presence in the heart of the devotee. If you remember the first canto, Narada Muni, when he was a small boy in his previous life, so the Lord appeared only for a moment in his heart. That time Lord tells that, okay, I will never appear in the heart which is contaminated with so many material desires. It's like that.
Okay. Yeah, understood now. Thank you. And if anybody else has to ask, or I just have two small questions, queries, Prabhuji, like in the same chapter 38-39 verse, Parpat, it comes that the Bindu Sarovar, about the Ganga, it comes that just the drop of perspiration which fell from the toe of the Lord became the sacred Ganges. So teardrop from the transcendental eyes of the Lord became Bindu Sarovar.
Hmm.
Like we also heard here now, Prabhuji, that at the time of that Bali Maharaj gave 3 feet land to Lord, and then third feet, second feet, he extended so much that it tear the coverings of the universe, and the sacred water in the celestial planet that started coming due to his tearing of the thing. And it is like, so means Ganga's appearance has two, three explanations, or it is Kalpa Ved, or how we understand.
No, not Kalpa Ved, but it is mentioned like that. See, that the toenails, when it is touching the universal shell, it pierced and the causal ocean came inside like that. The description is there at some place. Same thing, instead of saying that the universal shell is not pierced, but when Lord Trivikrama lifted his feet, the toe from the toenail, there came a drop of perspiration that became like Ganga. So in that way, it's like same thing only, but different way of narrating the entire pastime. So it is like that. So as you mentioned, it could be because of Kalpa Ved also. It could be a different way of narrating things also. So like that we can take.
Okay.
Maybe in a different Purana, it is mentioned like this. So in that way also you can take.
Okay, Prabhuji. And Prabhuji, Kapil Dev, like Swansha and Kala, that we discussed na, in the 32nd verse of the 21st chapter.
Yes.
That Swansha, you explain, is the direct expansion, and Kala is the expansion of the Swansha.
Direct expansion, yes. Second expansion.
Yeah. So, Kapil Dev, the mention of Kapil Dev also comes in this verse briefly. So, he is Swansha or Kala? He is Kala. Na?
He is Swansha. See, Swamsha Kala, if you take one example, is if Krishna is Swayam Bhagavan, then his Swamsha will be Bhagavan and Balramji. So from Balramji comes Narayana, from Narayana comes all these different avatars. So then 3-4 next are there. So in that way, so it is like a little bit distinction. So generally, the distinction, Pacharya say that the Vishnu Tattva is Swamsha, the Shakti Avesha avataras are Kala. That is our general description. Whichever avatar is called as, comes under the category of Shakti Avesh avatar, they are called as Kala. And whichever category of avataras comes under Swamsha, as Vishnu Tattvas, they are all called as Swamsha.
Okay.
So that is first expansion and second expansion. If they are Vishnu Tattva, they are Swamsha. Okay. If they are Shakti Avesh avataras, they are Kala.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Okay. Any other devotees have any query? Yes, Vinit Prabhu. Kuch puchne ka?
I have something to ask, but I am finding. I'll let you know in some time, bro.
Okay, Prabhu. No problem. Anyone else? Okay, no problem. Whenever you feel like us, you can ask. So let us go ahead with the conversation. So having heard from all this glorification, the words of glorification and the words of high regard to the Brahmanas from the mouth of Swayambhu Manu, and also the request made by Swayambhu Manu that my daughter, having heard from Narada Muni about your wonderful form, qualities and conduct, she decided that you are suitable to her in all respects. She wanted to marry you. And we also, as parents, would like to give her hand in marriage to you. So please accept this request. So that was the request. Now, Rishi Kardam Muni is going to reply. Ba Rishi Ruvacha Badam Udvodu Kamoham Apratacha Tavatmaja Avayor Anurupo. Adyo Vaibhahika Vidhi.
The great sage replied, "Certainly, I have a desire to marry, and your daughter has not yet married or given her word to anyone. Therefore, our marriage, according to the Vedic system, can take place."
Yeah. Here, one more point about Vedic system of marriage. So, I desire to marry her, no problem. Badam means certainly, accepting. Out of respect for you, I'll accept your request. Udvodu kamoham, I am desiring to marry your daughter. And so from my side, I'm okay. And from your side as parents, you have never given word to anybody else that your daughter will be married to them. And also your daughter also did not want to marry anybody else. So there is no objection from any side. So I'll accept. So this is Vedic ceremony of marriage. The parents should not be having any objection. The girl should not be having any objection. The boy should not be having any objection. That time marriage will go on nicely. If the father or parents already given word to somebody else, that person might come and disturb their marriage life like that. So that kind of things might happen. So keeping that thing in consideration, it tells that there was no prior the word given to somebody else that your daughter will be married to them. Such kind of thing is not there. And your daughter also never gave her word to anybody else. So I am ready to marry her today itself. So in that way. There were many considerations by Kardama Muni before accepting the daughter of Swayambhu Manu. Most important is that Devahuti had first of all fixed her mind on marrying him. She did not choose to have any other man as her husband. That is a great consideration because female psychology dictates that when a woman offers her heart to a man for the first time, it is very difficult for her to take it back. So like that. So Prabhupada expands on this particular theme. So it is like that. So that's why in the Puranas, we hear many times there are other kinds of marriage, such as Gandharva marriage and marriage by love, which are also accepted as marriage. Even if one is forcibly kidnapped and later on accepted as a wife, that is also accepted. So there are different variety of marriages. I think 6 varieties are there. I don't recall exactly their names, but 6 variety of there. Among them, one is called Gandharva marriage. Gandharva marriage is based on the acceptance of both the princess and the prince. So if both of them want to marry, they can marry. So then there is another type of marriage called Rakshasa, Rakshasa Rupa Vivaha. So Mother Rukmini, when she wrote letter to Lord Krishna that my brother made all the arrangements so that I will get married to Shishupal, but I do not want to marry Shishupal. And may you kindly come and forcibly abduct me from this entire in the midst of these arrangements and marry me in the style of a Rakshasa marriage. So forcefully abducting the girl from the marriage arrangements and marrying her. So this is called as a Rakshasa type of marriage. So that is there. So like that. That too with the consent of the girl. So sometimes without the consent of the girl also it can be done. But eventually the girls will accept. It is like the conditions you can see in the case of Ravana. Ravana forcibly abducted so many ladies, including Mother Sita also. But rest all accepted Ravana as their husband. But Mother Sita did not accept Ravana as her husband later on. So then eventually the same thing can be seen in the case of Narakasura. He also kidnapped so many girls with a desire to marry them or something like that. He kidnapped them, put them in jail. But later on, Lord Krishna came and killed him. And all those girls, all those ladies said that we want to marry you because we cannot go back to our home. Our parents will not accept us back. So we have no other option. Either die or may get married to you and live in a honorable way. So then Lord Krishna accepted all of them. So such kind of different marriages were there in the past. But mostly they are all in the Kshatriya lineage. All such kind of marriages may not be quite common in other Varnas. The Brahmanas, Vaishyas, Shudras may not be following all these things. But for Kshatriyas, all these 6 variety of marriages were allowed. So in that way. Gandharva marriage, Rakshasa Rupa marriage, and Swayamvar, and etc. all those different variety of marriages were there. कामस्सभूया नरदेवतेस्या पुत्र्या समाम्नाय विदौ प्रतीता क एव ते तनयां नारद नादृतेया स्वयैव कान्त्या क्षिपतिमिव श्रियम्।
Let your daughter's desire for marriage, which is recognized in the Vedic scriptures, be fulfilled. Who would not accept her hand? She is so beautiful that by her bodily luster alone, she excels the beauty of her ornaments.
Yeah. Since your daughter also desire to marry me, so there is no point in deriding this request. So I have no objection from my side. I would like to marry your daughter, because he already knew that the Lord himself arranged this marriage. So from his side there is no objection. At the same time, he might be having some inhibition that so Lord told, but whether the daughter is, I mean, whether the girl is happy to marry him, whether the parents may or may not be happy to marry him, but all of them are agreeing to give their daughter to him. So there is no objection from his side. Like that, he expresses his consent upon this marriage. Kardamuni wanted to marry Devahuti in the recognized manner of marriage present prescribed in the scriptures. As stated in the Vedic scripture, the first class process is to call the bridegroom to the home of the bride and hand her to him in charity with a dowry of necessary ornaments, gold, furniture, and other household paraphernalia. So this is what we see nowadays. The marriage generally happens at the girl's place. So after the marriage, the parents will give all the necessary things that are required for the newly wedded couple to live happily. So this is like the traditional marriage that happens. So the responsibility lies with the parents of the girl in order to find out a suitable person to be married to their daughter. And after marriage also, they need to have all the facilities that are required for them to stay happily. So this is how. Even though here they did not invite Kardamuni all the way to their home, because since Kardamuni is a Brahmana and is higher order in comparison to Kshatriyas, so they came all the way to the ashrama of Kardamuni and they wanted to fulfill their duties as the parents. So it's like that. So Prabhupada writes, so this form of marriage is prevalent among higher class Hindus even today, and is declared in the Shastras to confer great religious merit on the bride's father. To give a daughter in charity to a suitable son-in-law is considered to be one of the pious activity of the householder. It is actually called as kanyadan. Among all the variety of charities a householder can do, the best among them is kanyadan, offering their daughter in marriage to the hand of a suitable person. So it is like that. So here Prabhupada gets into some details. There are 8 forms of marriage mentioned in the scriptures, Manusmriti, but only one process of marriage, Brahma or Rajasika marriage, is now current. Other kinds of marriages by love, by exchange of garlands, or by kidnapping the bride are now forbidden in the Kali Age. So other kinds of marriages by love, by exchange of garlands, or this is by exchange of garlands is by Gandharva marriage, or by kidnapping the bride, that is Rakshasa type of marriage, are for now forbidden in the Kali Age. So formerly the Kshatriyas would at their pleasure kidnap a princess from another royal house, and there would be a fight between the Kshatriyas and the girl's family. Then if the kidnapper was the winner, the girl would be offered to him for marriage. Even Krishna married Rukmini by that process, and some of his sons and grandsons also married by kidnapping. So Samba kidnapped Duryodhana's daughter Lakshmana, that was there in the Bhagavatam 10th canto. You might have heard some time back. So there was a huge fight afterwards, and the Kauravas actually defeated him. And I think that is Samba only. Samba only. He defeated the Samba and arrested him. In order to release him, Balramji comes to Hastinapur, and when Duryodhana and other Kauravas kind of chastises Yadavas, so Balramji becomes very angry, and he said that I will drown the entire Hastinapur into Ganga. So with that saying those words, he actually using his plow, he was dragging entire Hastinapur into Ganga. Realizing their mistake, Duryodhana and all the other entourage of Kauravas, they came and fell at the lotus feet of Balramji and begged forgiveness. And later on, they gave Lakshmana and Samba accepting their marriage to Balramji. And Balramji brought them to Dwaraka. So that was there. And also, Lord Krishna, Pradyumna, and Aniruddha. So Aniruddha was the grandson of Krishna. Usha, a princess from other province. In her dream, she used to get the dreams of Aniruddha. And she informed her friend Chitraleka. And Chitraleka draw the image of the Aniruddha. When she understood that it is Krishna's grandson, Chitraleka in one night came to Dwaraka and took Aniruddha through her mystic potency to all the way to that kingdom. And there, I think that is Maheshmati. So our Maheshmati or Pragyotishipura. So there in the inner chambers, both Aniruddha and Usha were living happily for some times. And eventually they understood, the father of Usha understood, that was Banasura, understood that something is happening. So understanding that some boy is there in the chamber, inner chambers of his daughter. So he arrested him, Pradyumna. Understanding that Krishna's grandson was arrested by Banasura, Lord Krishna came with his army all the way up to Pragyotishipura or something, this town. And they had a good fight. That is where Banasura, who had 1,000 arms, all arms of his body were cut by Lord Krishna. Only 4 arms were left. And then eventually Banasura agreed the marriage of Pradyumna and Usha. Aniruddha and Usha. So it's like that. Like that, there are many marriages that are mentioned. So Krishna's grandsons kidnapped Duryodhana's daughter, which caused a fight between Kuru and Yadu families. So actually Krishna's son, Samba, only kidnapped Duryodhana's daughter. Krishna's grandson went to that city where the fight between Banasura happened. All these past times are mentioned in the 10th canto. So like that it happens. So but unfortunately today, the system of marriage is happening only ritual. It is said in the scriptures, Kalo Shudra Sambhava. In the age of Kali, everyone will be like Shudras. The traditional social customs are not followed in this age, although formerly they were followed strictly. So something like this. Yeah, yes, Mataji, you wanted to say something?
Yes, Guruji, two things, the two confusions were there. Like, we also see nowadays, you know, some people, they kidnap the girl, or they just forcefully try to marry the girl. Like, so with how those marriages are considered, or they are going against the script.
So as I just mentioned, all those 8 types of marriages are only meant for Kshatriyas, not for anyone and everyone. So those who are kidnapping, are they Kshatriyas? First of all, we should see that. So then whoever and anyone cannot kidnap and marry like that. They cannot say that I will marry you like that. Even that kidnapping also,
they should not be doing. That is how we should understand.
Yeah, that kidnapping also should be accepted by the girl. If the girl accepts, everything will be right. It's like Mother Sita was kidnapped by Ravana. But Mother Sita never accepted that kidnap. So that's why there was a huge fight between Lord Rama and Ravana, and eventually was killed. So that is what will happen. So it should be done with the consent of the girl. Like Rukmini was kidnapped by Lord Krishna. Okay.
And other thing, like I was trying to understand, Prabhuji, why according to Vedic system, it could be the thing that it is to be offered to a particular boy, a suitable boy. Then everything, whatever paraphernalia they need for living married life has to be given by the parents of the daughter, like parents of the bride. Because then in that may be a forceful thing from the bridegroom side, but that is also Shastras advocate that should be done, no?
No, it was never a forceful thing. Out of love and affection for the daughter, the parents would provide all those things. Nowadays it has become like a dowry, and it is insisted forcefully. But in the past it was never Hare a Krishna. Forceful insistence. It was like out of love, out of consideration Hare that Krishna, their children should never be in trouble. So they would offer all those things. Even 10th canto, first chapter, if you read, when Devaki married to Vasudev, so Devaka, the father of Devaki, also presented so many gifts to Vasudev. Since the marriage is happening,
I think there is some also mention exactly where, I don't remember, that if the parents are not in financially not in the position.
See, Mataji, we are talking about the marriage between kings. Don't correlate that marriage with ordinary marriages. So, I mean, the same principle can be applied to other marriages between in the other, among others also. But we are talking about the marriages in kings. Kings mean they will have all the, in spite of having all the facilities, still they are offering. That shows their affection toward their children. That's all. It was not a forcibly insisting thing. Nowadays, it has become a force. याम हर्म पृष्ठे क्वनदंग्रि शोभां विक्रीडितां कंदुक विवलाक्षीं विश्वावसुर्नपत स्वाद्विमानान् विलोक्य सम्मोह विमूढचेता.
If I am speaking, you are getting it late, or you are speaking, I am getting it
So seems that you are getting late. That's why we are having
crossed up. I have heard that Vishwasut.
Yeah, please.
I have heard that Vishwasu, the great Gandharva, his mind stupefied with infatuation, fell from his airplane after seeing your daughter playing with a ball on the roof of the palace. For she was indeed beautiful with her tinkling ankle bells and her eyes moving to and fro.
Yeah. So one more important thing here is me mentioning that your daughter was not seen by any other men also, because since she is a daughter born and brought up in the royalty, royal order, the children of royal order would never come out of their antapura or palace. So there was no chance that somebody else would have seen her. So that somebody else might wanted to marry her, that is not possible. But there is we have heard that there was a Gandharva known as Vishwasu or something like that. So he just had seen the brilliance of your daughter when your daughter was playing in your courtyard on the terrace or something like that, while traveling in his Vimana in the sky. He just saw the brilliance of your daughter. Just by seeing the brilliance of your daughter, he kind of fell down. Matlab, he kind of became unconscious. So that was the greatness of the beauty of your daughter. Who would refuse that beautiful girl? So like that, he's in a way is glorifying the beauty of the Devahuti. At the same time, he's also telling that there was no chance that somebody had already eyed upon your daughter, because no one can see her. So there is no way that I can deny the marriage with your daughter. So like the various conditions, he's kind of trying to convince mean trying to convey that. So there is no other condition to indicate that I don't want to marry your daughter. So it is like that. Tam prarthayantim lalana lalamam aveshita sri charanaya drishtam vasram manorvuccha padas sasharam ko nanu manyeta budobi yatam.
What wise man could not welcome her, the very ornament of womanhood, the beloved daughter of Swayambhava Manu and sister of Uttanapada? Those who have not worshipped the gracious feet of the goddesses of fortune cannot even perceive her, yet she has come of her own accord to seek my hand.
And he glorifies other qualities of Devahuti also. So which wise man cannot welcome her? So she is the ornament of all the women, and getting to marry such kind of a girl is only possible for those who worship Mother Lakshmi. Without the special blessings of Mother Lakshmi, no one would ever marry such a beautiful girl. Since I have already worshipped Lord Narayana, seeking for a suitable girl, I have also worshipped Mother Lakshmi. Since I have received the blessings of Lord Narayana, I have also received the blessings of Mother Lakshmi. So I had the good fortune of receiving the hand of your daughter. Otherwise, it is not so easy. And more than that, your daughter yourself has decided to marry me. That is my greatest fortune. Ko na anumanyata budho abhiyatam. So which kind of wise person will reject the hand of your daughter? Because from all conditions, from all directions, everything is perfectly fitting in. So how can I say no to your daughter to accept her hand in marriage like that? Kardamuni praised the beauty and qualification of Devahuti in different ways. Devahuti was actually the ornament of all ornamented beautiful girls. So it's like that. अतो भजिष्ये समयेन साध्विं यावत् तेजो बिभ्रुयादात्मनो मे अतो धर्मां पारमहंस मुख्यान् शुक्ल प्रोक्तान् बहुमन्ने विहिंश्रान्.
Therefore, I shall accept this chaste girl as my wife on the condition that after she bears semen from my body, I shall accept the life of devotional service accepted by the most perfect human beings. That process was described by Lord Vishnu. It is free from envy.
Yeah, he says that. I will accept the hand of your daughter, but with one condition. I will be in household order, living with your daughter, till the time I beget children. That was to fulfill the order of my father. My father wanted me to get married and beget children through them. The population would continue. So, till that particular instruction of my father is fulfilled, I will be in gross order. Later on, I'll take up to renunciation. Ato dharman paramahamsa mukyan. I would like to practice paramahamsa dharma. The best of Paramahamsas, Paramahamsa Mukhyan, whatever dharma being followed by the best of Paramahamsas, the devotional service, I would like to follow that. I have been taken to renunciation. I am not saying that I would not marry. I would like to marry, since the Lord himself, Shukla Proktam, the Lord himself has told that Swayambhu Manu's daughter, Swayambhu Manu will come with his daughter and give in marriage to you. So since Lord only ordained, I will accept. And Lord only told that, after fulfilling the order of your father, please go to forest after taking the renunciation and distribute fearlessness to all over, and then eventually you will attain me. Since Lord has told me to marry your daughter, I will marry. Since Lord has told me to take up renunciation after fulfilling the order of my father Brahma, and then go back home, back to Godhead. So with this condition, if it is agreeable to you and your wife and your daughter, I will accept the hand of your daughter in marriage. So this was the condition put by our Kardama. Kardama Muni had put this condition that if it is agreeable to you, all of you, then I will marry your daughter. So it is like that. So one interesting point, Prabhupada actually kind of mentions a couple of points mentions actually. He says that Kardama Muni did not want to be householder for the whole span of his life because he was conversant with the Vedic principles of human life. According to Vedic principle, the first part of life should be utilized in brahmacharya for the development of character and spiritual qualities. In the next part of life, one may accept a wife and beget children, but one should not beget children like cats and dogs, etc. Kardama Muni desired to beget a child who would be a ray of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One should beget a child who can perform the duties of Lord Vishnu. Otherwise, there is no need to produce children. There are two kinds of children born of good fathers. One is educated in Krishna consciousness so that he can be delivered from the clutches of Maya in that very life. And the other is a ray of Supreme Personality of Godhead and teaches the world the ultimate goal of life. I mean, this is like Prabhupada said that there are two kinds of children. One is the ray of Vishnu. The other one is the devotee who would become devotee eventually, etc. So, like that, some points about the Paramahamsa order, which is without envy. So basically, Daya Sarvabhuteshu, with an intention to show compassion to all the living entities, educating them in how to obtain fearlessness. That was the main duty of Paramahamsas, who would travel from place to place and distributing Krishna consciousness to everyone. So that kind of thing he wanted to take up and engage in that service. So with that intention, he tells that I will marry in order to fulfill the order of my father. If they get children, when the children are born, then I will take up to renunciation. That was the condition. Are the request made by Kardama Muni. So why he is making that request? Yato abhavat vishvam idam vichitram samstasyate yatra chavat vavatishtaye tishtate prajapatinam patiresha mayam Param Pramanam Bhagavan Ananta.
The highest authority for me is the unlimited Supreme Personality of Godhead, from whom this wonderful creation emanates, and in whom its sustenance and dissolution rest. He is the origin of all Prajapatis, the personalities meant to produce living entities in this world.
So here he says that why I am putting this order. This condition, the condition is because my father Lord Brahma told me to get married and beget children, but Lord Vishnu, the father of Lord Brahma, the master of Lord Brahma and all the other Prajapatis, had told me to get married to your daughter and beget children in order to fulfill the desire of my father, but eventually he ordered me to take on to renunciation, travel from place to place, distributing fearlessness to everyone, and eventually come back home back to Godhead. So how can I deny the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the father of my father, the lord of every living entity of this world? Yato abhavat vishvam idam vichitram, from whom comes this entire universe and in whom merges back the entire universe after the annihilation. So prajapati nam patiresha mayam, he the lord of all the prajapatis and also me. Param pramanam, he the ultimate pramana. So whatever he said is superior to than that is told by my father, Lord Brahma. So how can I cannot stay as a householder for the entire life. So I will remain as a householder till the time I beget children, till the time I fulfill the order of my father. And then I'll follow the order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So that was the, so he is actually telling that why he is putting this condition. So that is because the Lord himself told me to follow this in this way. So I am putting this order. Kindly consider this and do the needful. Kardamuni was ordered by his father Prajapati Brahma to produce children. So it is like that. So basically Prabhupada said that Kardama Muni preferred to devote his life as a servant of the Lord in Paramahamsa knowledge and to beget a child only for that purpose, not to beget numberless children to fill up the vacancies in the universe. So it's like that. So among all the six kinds of runas, like it is mentioned in the Bhagavatam 11th canto, or it was read in the Bhagavad Gita first chapter only. Devarshi bhutat nanam cha pitrunam nakim karo nayam runicha rajan sarvatmanaya sharanam sharanyam gato mukundam parihatta kartum. So just by birth one is actually becomes indebted to six kinds of people: the devatas, rishis, devarshi bhuta, the living entities, bhuta apta, the relatives, nanam, the human beings in general, and devarshi bhutapta runam cha pitrunam, and the pitrus, the forefathers. The runa to forefathers is liquidated, is cleared by getting married and begetting children. So by getting married to a suitable girl from a honorable family and begetting a bona fide children, through that one can liquidate the debt one has to the forefathers. So for that reason always they want to marry, the men want to marry a girl from the honorable family and want to beget a son. So by begetting a son, they liquidate the debt to the forefathers. So this is anticipated and desired and followed by all the men in the past, all the parents in the past also. So it is like that. But Prabhupada said that should not be the only purpose. But one should get married and beget children of Krishna consciousness. That should be the main purpose. Instead of begetting just numberless children, just like that. But one should always beget Krishna conscious children. That is the best thing one can do. It's like that. Prabhupada says. So that was the reply given by Kardama Muni unto Swayambhuva Manu. Now, Swayambhuva Manu, and he is going to discuss with his wife and daughter, and with their consent he is going to marry his daughter to Kardama Muni. So any queries till now? Hare Krishna, all of you are able to follow?
Yes, Prabhuji. But I think there is some time lag in between happens.
Okay. What about others?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Okay. So now Maitreya is going to tell what Swayambhuva Muni is doing. Maitreya uvacha. There is a lot of time lag happening. Okay. Okay, we'll do one thing. we'll take a break now. During the break, I request all of you to, I will close the meeting and I will start the meeting in another 5 minutes. After 5 minutes, we'll start the meeting. So that